Welcome to Terrific Talk. My name is Tom Anderson.
Tom Anderson.
I feel ready to go another 9 innings.
Touchdown!
I feel ready to go another 9 innings.
Touchdown!
Today, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
Terrific Talk Podcast. Welcome back, Terrific Talk Podcast.
Welcome to Terrific Talk. Beautiful day here from the Hoboken Studios in New Jersey. Thanks for checking the podcast out, whether you're listening on iTunes, the CLNS Media app, or straight off our brand new website, clnsmedia.com. Great to be with you. I've got an awesome guest today. Michael Lee is the NBA senior writer for Yahoo Sports. Michael spent 11 years prior working at the Washington Post covering the NBA. That's where I first started really reading his work. He's a great writer, great student of the game. I'm really excited to have him on. Let me bring him in here. Michael Lee, welcome to Terrific Talk.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So, what NBA team did you grow up rooting for? Where did your love of the NBA come from?
My love of the NBA started with Magic Johnson. You know, he was the guy that just blew me away. Showtime Lakers, that whole just up and down, up-tempo style of play. I just fell in love with it. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, so the Kings were supposed to be my team, and then they left me to go to Sacramento, and I've been bitter about that for the last 30 some odd years.
I've
never gotten over it. So I was a Laker fan, since I didn't have a home team, and so I was with the Lakers up until 99, and I divorced the Lakers when they traded Eddie Jones and Nick Van Exel, who were two of my favorite players. And I said, I'm done rooting for teams.
Wow.
I'll go ahead and enjoy basketball. And it's turned out to be a wise move because 3 years later, I wound up covering the league. And it kind of worked out that I didn't have a team that I was had any rooting interest with.
Yeah, everybody says once you start covering the team, you know, you don't have a rooting interest as much. It just changes for you. The fan side of you kind of goes away.
Yeah, it does. I mean, you start to appreciate the games and the situations that will benefit you, whether, like, you don't want overtime because you don't want to miss deadline. You don't,
yeah.
You know, you kind of root for scenarios as opposed to teams.
Right. At what age did you decide you wanted to be a sports writer? What made you decide this career?
Probably when I was in high school. You know, I was, I used to watch, you know, ESPN all the time, and I thought I'd be a commentator. You know, I thought that would be the path I'd take. But then, you know, I started going to journalism camps when I was in sophomore, after my sophomore year in high school. Started doing some things for the Kansas City Star, my hometown paper. So I was writing for them. I actually was drawing for them. The first thing I ever had published in a newspaper was my artwork. I used to draw a lot.
Oh, wow.
I thought I'd be a cartoonist. I thought that would be what I wound up doing in the, when it came to print. But I wound up becoming a writer, and I don't even draw anymore. So that dream died a hard death. When I decided to become a sports writer, I think once I started being around journalism, I knew that eventually I was going to wind up in sports. I was fortunate that when I was in college, my professors kind of prohibited me from doing sports internships right away. So I did a news internship my freshman year at the Kansas City Star. I did a featured internship at the Fort Lauderdale Sun Sentinel. And then finally, after my junior year, the AJC, Imaginal Constitution, gave me a chance to be a sports writer. So it worked because I was able to incorporate what I learned from covering news, what I did from doing features, and then, you know, adding sports. Because I think that's the beauty of sports writing is that you kind of have to have a nose for it all, you know. You got to chase the stories wherever the news is. You got to be able to tell compelling stories as a feature writer. And then the other element, of course, is writing a game story, and being able to tell people what they just saw, break it down, explain it to them, and also give them, a vision of what they didn't see, you know, because you have access and you have the ability to communicate with players, and there are things that you can add that can elevate what you just witnessed. So I'm grateful for the path that I took because it helped me. I think it helped me reach the point where I am now.
What do you like doing more, game stories or feature type stories?
I like features. You know, that's the one thing that is always a joy. If you can spend time with a guy and have him open up or share some part of his life that other people may not know, or, you know, that always is something that I've enjoyed doing over time. You know, I think that a lot of times people forget that these players are humans. They forget that, you know, there's more to them than their ability to put the ball in the basket. And although that is what is the basis for our conversation, it's good to have talks with guys where they can reveal who they are and what they are, that goes beyond what people see on the court.
Absolutely. What are some of your most memorable feature stories that you've done where you've really had somebody open up to you?
I guess the one that's going to stand out probably for a long time is the this piece on Caron Butler when he was with the Washington Wizards. I was covering the team at the time, and he had a pretty complex, you know, upbringing. You know, he went to jail for possession of drugs and guns when he was in high school. Of course, he was released, and he wound up, you know, going to UConn and becoming Caron Butler All-Star forward. But yeah. When I went and did the story, my editor just told me, like, to make it a goal to, you know, tell us something we don't know. And it was a challenge because so much had been written about him for many years that a lot of people kind of knew the story. They knew that he came back. He sold drugs. He sold crack from the corner in Racine, Wisconsin. And, you know, he did all these things that he, you know, at one point, you know, he knows what he was. but when I went to his hometown in Racine, I was fortunate enough to find a police officer who had actually had a chance to arrest Caron after he got out of jail. And he had the potential to send Caron to jail for 10 years,
wow,
which would have ended his entire basketball pursuit. He would have spent another statistic caught up in the American prison system, and he never would have had a chance to have the life that he has. But the cop didn't believe that the drugs belonged to him, and they didn't. And so he didn't arrest him. He gave Caron a chance. Caron's mom begged the cop to not let him go. And by the end, you know, many years later, cop wound up having a son, and one of his favorite players wound up being Caron Butler.
Crazy.
And the only two jerseys that his kid wore, I think they were Michael Redd and Caron Butler. So this cop had a chance to basically, he could have ruined Caron's life just arrested him just to get, he could just mark it down. Yeah, I got an arrest, and here we go. But he trusted his gut, gave Caron another chance, and he wound up being an All-Star. So that's probably the story that stands out. I mean, I've had others, but that's the one that always stands out to me as one that I had the most fun.
That's an amazing story. You wrote a great piece this week on whether or not the Cavs-Warriors rivalry is over. Everybody pretty down the Cavs right now. But Kevin Durant told you he thinks the Cavs are going to make it back to the finals this year. What do you think?
I agree with him. You know, I think that as long as LeBron is there, as long as, you know, until there's a player, you know, who can look LeBron in the eye and tell him, you know, it's over for you.
Yeah.
And do it four times. I have a hard time seeing somebody actually doing it. And that's really what it comes down to. You know, if you look at the teams that LeBron has lost to over the years, you had Dirk take him out. You had Tim Duncan take him out. Kawhi Leonard or whatever, just, you had somebody, Steph Curry, you know, these are people that have sort of said, okay, LeBron, we know you're great, but I'm not going to let you win. And unfortunately, in the Eastern Conference, there hasn't been a player or a team that's been able to say, you're done, you know, and that's why he has seven straight trips, and why he'll likely have eight, because even though there's always a new team emerging, you know, there's the Indiana, there's Atlanta for a minute, there's Toronto, there's always a team that kind of, you know, Boston, obviously. But LeBron has found a way to just say, okay, enough, and made light work of just about everybody. You know, he had a couple of challenges there with the Pacers because that was just a really solid team. That was just a really good team. There wasn't just one player that they could say, okay, we're going to beat you. But now you look at around the East, as much as I like what Toronto's doing, as much as I like, you know, what Boston's been doing all year, I just think that beating LeBron four times from a team or a person in the East I don't know. I just don't see it. But then, like I said in the column, Kyrie Irving is somebody who believes the Earth is flat. So if he believes the Earth is flat, then he probably thinks that he can take out LeBron. So, and that's the first step. You got to have some level of belief that others don't have that'll put you over the top. So, but I also feel like if there's one scenario that LeBron is going to refuse to have happen, that's letting Boston beat him and let Kyrie get in the upper hand after leaving the last offseason.
No chance he'll let that happen. One guy who can possibly go toe-to-toe with LeBron, I don't think it's this year, but it's close, is that guy in Milwaukee, Giannis. He's close, but not there yet. I don't think so.
Nah, he's so young. Yeah. He hasn't won a playoff series yet. You know, there are levels that, you know, you got to take some steps before you just go at the king, or whatever, or lack of a better phrase. You know, you gotta earn it. And he's going through the process now, being a superstar, dealing with the pressures of double teams and everything. He's been quite impressive, and his growth is incredible considering, you know, where he was when he arrived. You know, five quick years, you know, he's become, you know, one of those guys that's going to be the face of the league going forward, and it's pretty incredible. You think about international players and the reputations that they've had over the years. They've always been good. They've always been a presence in the league. But if you look at Giannis, you look at Embiid, you look at Porzingis, you look at Ben Simmons, you know, there's so many guys now that are becoming the face of the NBA, which says a lot about how much the game has grown and just also about how fans nowadays are so conditioned to it that it's not even a big deal.
It's amazing. It's a global game. The Spurs, Kawhi Leonard out indefinitely, sadly, with that quad injury. Same injury that kept him out the first 27 games. It seems kind of weird. The Spurs are kind of not giving out too many details. What have you heard about the Kawhi Leonard situation? What's going on there?
Well, I mean, it's a situation where it's not just a normal injury. It's sort of a tendon issue that, you know, is basically just wear and tear that just needs time to heal. And he hasn't healed properly. And that's a huge concern. It's a really confusing issue because, you know, he looks fine, but then he gets out there and he doesn't look right, and he doesn't feel right afterward. So the Spurs have to play cautious because this is the future. This is the franchise now. And they don't want to take any chances on his long-term health, even if, you know, they feel like they have a chance this season. They don't want to risk anything. So it's a sad situation because you want to see the best players out there and you want to see every team, you know, coming with their best, especially, you know, this time of the year. But I think we also want to see a healthy Kawhi Leonard. We want to see him having a long career. We don't want to see it like situation with Derrick Rose where he was banged up the year after he won MVP. And he kept trying to come back and kept coming back, even though he wasn't right. Then all of a sudden he blew out his knee and he's never been the same. You know, I mean, I hate to use that situation, but when it comes to Kawhi Leonard, the Spurs have to be cautious because the last thing they want to do is to have him go out there, try to compensate for this one injury and wind up hurting something else. So that's kind of where it stands. But the thing about the Spurs is during a regular season, there are no expendable players.
Yeah.
There's nobody that they can't win without. They find a way. The fact that LaMarcus Aldridge is putting up all-star numbers in his absence, I think it was good that he had that long talk with Pop in the summer. And you can see that it's starting to pay off for the whole team. And you just hope that Kawhi can get back and that when he's back, he's able to go full out. Because it'll be fun just to see the best of the best really duking it out in the postseason this year.
100%. Last question. The Paul Pierce, Isaiah Thomas tribute controversy just gotten so wacky. I think, were dead. It's not their fault. They didn't create the problem. Celtics are the one who just screwed this whole thing up. What is your whole take on this thing?
Yeah, I think it's a bad look. And I'm really upset with fans because other people who decided that the best way to make their point is to try to belittle Paul Pierce, who's one of the greatest Celtics ever and deserves to have his own day.
Totally.
You know, it's like he deserves to have it, you know, for all that he did for that franchise and for all the years that he had to put up with where they didn't have any help for him, and then he gave him a championship. You know, I think he deserves to have his own day. And I think Isaiah deserves a tribute, but the Celtics needed to do it one way. You know, they tell Isaiah, hey, February 11th is Paul Pierce's day. So you're coming to town January 3rd. If you're going to be with the team, we want to play your tribute video. You can stand up then. You can wave to the crowd and do whatever. But February 11th is Paul Pierce's day. I'm pretty sure if they gave Isaiah that situation, he wouldn't have been, oh, yeah, just hold off to the next time. No one was thinking about it. No one was even conscious of the fact that February 11th was Paul Pierce's day, except for Paul Pierce.
Right.
So when they told him that they wanted to do that, he got upset because, you know, for all that he gave that franchise and for what his trade, what that Celtics, what that trade to Brooklyn did to keep the Celtics going forward, you know, he didn't want to end his career playing for the Clippers. He didn't want to be a Clipper at the end of his career. He wanted to finish it out as a member of the Boston Celtics. But he accepted the trade. The Celtics have benefited in the long term for it, and he deserved to get whatever he wanted. But I think if the Celtics had just handled it properly from the beginning, you know, told Isaiah, hey, you know, I know you want your family there and everything, but this is the day that we have to recognize you. And I don't think he would have had any problem with it. He would have worked around it, and he would have made it work. And I think the fans would have appreciated having that moment then, because they still gave him a standing ovation, you know, that night. And I feel like now people are, like, taking shots at Paul Pierce, and I'm like, this is stupid. And then people saying that Isaiah Thomas didn't mean anything. And, you know, that's whatever. I mean, the fans of Boston loved him. The fans of Boston appreciated his contributions. And considering what he did to play last postseason, you know, he deserves some recognition from the team. So I don't have a problem with that. But I do think that Paul deserves the respect of having a day that was about him. And it's not too much to ask for a guy who brought championship number 17 to that city.
No question about it. He definitely deserves his own day. He's just speaking the truth. Michael, this was great. Thank you for coming on. Thank you for coming on the pod today. Everybody check out Michael on Twitter. His handle is @MrMichaelLee. Michael, good luck the rest of the season. Thanks again.
Hey, thank you, man. Appreciate it.